alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First of all, I can express my happiness to be able to talk with you today. I wish I could have been here in person, of course, with you. I miss you guys all so much. This is alhamdulillah, hopefully sometime soon, inshallah. I know a lot of you don't know me. My name is Yusra Kandel. I was a previous teacher here in Nur al-Iman School. And hopefully, Rabb, inshallah, I'll join this blessed and very lovely family soon. I had some thoughts and I couldn't think of anyone more important to me on a personal level and to our community on a higher level than you that I would share these thoughts with. And I would like to start with a very dear hadith to my heart that usually really touches me, and I hope it touches you as well. And it says that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah has angels who roam around earth seeking gatherings where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name is mentioned in. And they sit with these people, surrounding them with their wings. So basically right now in the multipurpose room you're sitting and we're mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names, the angels are gathering up right now. They're calling on to each other, come along, come along. There are people who are mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and they're surrounding us with their wings. Try to really imagine this. And not just surrounding their wings here around us, but from here all the way up to the lowest heavens. Imagine how blessed that is and how blessed and honored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this is happening right now. And after everybody departs, that is you, of course, inshallah, the angels will ascend and rise up to the heavens. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and of course He's the most knowing, He's going to ask them, where have you come from? And they're going to say, we have come from some servants of yours on earth, Allah. And He's going to say, you know, what were they doing? And they're going to say, they were glorifying you, subhanallah, exalting you, Allahu Akbar, witnessing that there's no God but you, la ilaha illallah, praising you, alhamdulillah, and asking favors of you. And He's going to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and what do they ask of me? They say, they ask of you your paradise, Allah. He says, and have they seen my paradise? They say, no, O Lord. He says, and how would it be if they had actually seen my paradise? And they continue going on and they say, and they ask protection of you, Allah. He says, from what do they ask protection of me? They say, from hellfire, O Lord. He says, and have they seen my hellfire? They'll say, oh no. And how would it be had they seen my hellfire? They say, they ask you for forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then He says, I have forgiven them and I have bestowed upon them what they have asked. And I have granted them sanctuary from which they have asked protection from, and that's hellfire. Then the angels say, but O Lord, among them is so-and-so, a much sinning servant, a person who sins a lot, who was merely passing by and just sat down with them. And He says, and unto him I have given forgiveness. He who sits with such people shall not suffer. He who sits with such people shall not suffer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about you, each and every one of you, people whom He has chosen out of billions specifically to be here in His house, in this school, to be teaching His successors on earth, His khulafa on earth. Believe me, none of us have the say in where we work or what we work. It's all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's planning, but it's up to us what we do with what He has given us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily, Allah and His angels and those who inhabit the heavens and the earth, even the ants in their holes and the fish in their waters, bless the good teachers of mankind. Hadith of At-Tirmidhi. Inna Allah wa malaikatu wa ahla samawati wal ard hatta an-naml fi juhriha wa hatta al-hut li yusalluna ala muallim an-nas al-khayr. Can you imagine how many ants there are? How many fish, angels, creations of Allah? But not just that, but Allah Himself, Allah blessing you for something you do every day in your life, something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you with, a chance not given to everyone in His life. Can you picture how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is honoring you? He's putting you in this high rank, in this specific position. And from here, I would have to talk. If we were put in such a position by our Creator, then how should we be like? What should we look like from inside? What would He expect us to look like, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Us, the role models for these children, who are amana between our hands, pieces of soft clay that we mold every day. They're going to be what we make of them, what you make of them. And believe me, kids pick up everything we do. And I'm not just talking about in our school, but of course as well at home. The Prophet ﷺ said, I was not sent except to complete the good of manners. He didn't say I was sent to teach you how to pray or how to do Hajj or pray Zakat, which of course are very important pillars of our Islam. But he said, I was not sent except to complete our good manners. How we deal with each other, how we respect each other, especially in an environment with children around us. Our religion is based on the concept of a community, not each one of us divided, but a community. If we do not love each other and love for each other what we love for ourselves, that can be achieved. If we don't respect each other, despite our differences and our different point of views, our different backgrounds, our different cultures, that can be achieved either. And most important, and which I think personally is most important, is backbiting or slandering, which I consider the biggest bug that can make a whole and entire community collapse. The Prophet ﷺ said, عن معاذ بن جبل رضي الله عنه, said, I said, O Messenger of Allah, tell me of a deed which will take me into paradise and keep me away from the hellfire. And he said, the Prophet ﷺ said, you have asked me about a great matter, yet it is indeed an easy matter for him to whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it easy. It is that you worship Allah without associating anything with him, that you perform the prayers, that you pay the zakat, that you fast during Ramadan, and that you make the pilgrimage to the house. The basic things, praying, fasting, salah, and so on. And then the Prophet ﷺ added, shall I not guide you to the gates of goodness? Fasting is a shield, charity extinguishes sin as water extinguishes fire, and a man's prayer in the middle of the night, and he went on reciting a surah from the Quran. Then he said, shall I not also tell you of the peak of the matter, its pillar, and its topmost part? I said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. He said, the peak of the matter is Islam, submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The pillar is prayer, and its topmost part is jihad. And then the Prophet ﷺ added to all of this whole bundle, and shall I not tell you of the controlling of all of that? How do you control all of that? All of these things that he just mentioned. I said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. So he took a hold of his tongue and he said, restrain this, his tongue, restrain this. I said, O Prophet of Allah, will we be held accountable for what we say? He said, may your mother be bereft of you. Is there anything that topples people on their faces, or he said, on their noses, into the hellfire, other than the jests of their tongues? I know it's very difficult. We get caught up in our daily lives, our differences, our disagreements. But stop. Stop and think for a minute before you talk. Think of what you're going to say. What is it going to lead to? And think where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put you. You as a teacher, could you say what you're going to say? A man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what do you do? What do you fear of the most? What do you fear of the most? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam pointed to his tongue. Do you see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's way of warning us? Once he holds his tongue, another time he points to his tongue. He's telling us, be careful, be very careful of this whole area here, be careful of it. And have you not realized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed barriers for us on our mouth? First our lips, then our teeth, and then he gave us only one tongue, but he gave us two ears, so that we may listen more than we talk. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, let whosoever believes in Allah, and in the last day either speak good or be silent. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. And he says, he who believes in Allah. Do you see the importance here of restraining or holding, being able to hold and control your tongue, and how he connects it to believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in the Day of Judgment? We all believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but how do we apply that? By restraining. So he says, believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So first you think, before saying anything, I believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What am I going to say? I have to stop first. I have to think. And then I speak. So when I speak, you know what you're going to say. And what comes out of your mouth comes out right. And it couldn't be displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because you initially believed in Allah before you spoke. And as he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, مَا يَلْفَظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. Not a word does he utter, but there's a watcher by him ready to record. Everything is recorded. Everything we say is recorded. And it's going to be just played back later on in front of everybody. Even if we say it between each other, it's going to be all played back again. The Prophet ﷺ says, a Muslim is a person who people are safe from his tongue and his hands. And it's just as if we're going around with a knife, scarring people, talking behind their back, saying rumors, even gestures, or making fun of somebody is considered backbiting. Saying about someone, may Allah guide him, رَبِّنَا يَهْدِي. The tone itself has sarcasm, and it's in it, it's belittling to your sister or brother. And to Allah, it's a major sin. He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّنْ قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّنْ نِسَاءٍ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُنْ وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ بِئْسَ الْإِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ وَمَن لَّمْ يَتُبْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. O you who believe, let not some men among you laugh at others. It may be that the latter are better than the former. Nor let some woman laugh at others. It may be that the latter are better than the former. Nor defame, nor be sarcastic to each other, nor call each other by offensive nicknames. Ill-seeming is a name connoting wickedness, to be used of one, other after he has believed, and those who do not repent are indeed doing wrong. The Prophet ﷺ, a person who backbites does not enter heaven. لا يدخل النمام الجنة. A person who backbites does not enter heaven. Let that just sink in and feel it, and think of it before you speak. A person goes around saying, do you know what she just said about you? Did you see what she just did? Or even saying, oh, I can't tell you what she said. Or I can't tell you what just happened. That itself is considered backbiting, which causes affliction, fitna, and brings down the oneness that's in our community. Feeling, how could I feel when somebody comes and tells me, did you hear what you, I can't tell you what she said about you. How would I feel inside me? How would I feel before, after coming that, trying to deal with that person? We have to think of these things and have to think of the consequences of what we say and how it would have an impact on our entire community, not on just that person that you spoke to. And as we also know, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's an ayah where the angels ask the people coming into hellfire or into Saqar, which is an area in hellfire, مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي Saqar. قالوا لم نكن من المصلين ولم نكن نطعم المسكين وكنا نخوض مع الخائدين. What has brought you into the fire of hell? They will say, we were not of those who offered prayers, nor did we feed the poor, and we indulged in objectionable talk with those who indulge therein. People talking about somebody, and we stand there and we listen. We don't stop them. We don't defend those people who are being talked about. Whether it's true or false, we shouldn't allow that. We are Muslims. We're teachers put in such a perfect and in such an honorable rank. We can't be in that position. We can't. How could we be after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put us in this position? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was passing over a grave, and he said, they're being tortured in their graves, and not for something so big. Then he stopped and said, actually, it is big. One of them used to walk among people with backbiting. أيحب أحدكم أي فلا I'm so sorry ولا يغتب أحدكم أحدا أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيكم ميتا فكرهتموه. Can you imagine how the Prophet pictured it? Imagine yourself holding a piece of human flesh from a dead corpse and you're biting into it. Very intense. Try to picture it. The person sitting next to you, could you imagine biting into their flesh dead? It's just very intense. The Prophet ﷺ was once walking with his companions, and he heard two of them who were walking ahead of him, and they were talking about somebody. He stayed silent, but they kept on going. And he said so-and-so, and this person is so-and-so. So he walked up to them and he said, go ahead, floss. They looked at each other, you know, saying, floss from what, Ya Rasulullah? We have not eaten any meat. He said, yes, you have. You ate the flesh of your brother dead. You ate the flesh of your brother dead. SubhanAllah. The Prophet ﷺ said, he who defends the honor of his Muslim brother, Allah will secure his face against the fire on the day of resurrection. And we all need that. We're in need of anything to hold on to. And as he says in the Holy Quran, and when they hear false talk, they withdraw from it. الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. And he says, verily, the hearing and the sight and the heart of each of those will be questioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will be accounted. We will be accounted for everything we do or say. And again, I have to come back to the same point and say, don't forget. Don't forget who you are. You're Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's successor on this earth. أنتم خلفاء الله في الأرض. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't forget where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put you. How he honored you by being a teacher. Allah put you somewhere very special. Make the best of it. Renew your niyyah every day. Every day remind yourself why Allah chose me to be here doing what I'm doing. And always look at the bigger picture. Through all your differences and all the distractions behind your back. And look at the bigger goal. and that is to sculpt something beautiful called the Children of Nur al-Iman. These children, inshallah, one day will come and hold your hands and lead you in through the gates of Jannah. And I'd like to end with a little dua that one of my teachers taught me and is very dear to me. And say, Allahumma istaghdimna wa la tastabdilna abadan ma ahyaytana ya Rabb. Allahumma istaghdimna wa la tastabdilna abadan ma ahyaytana. Oh Allah, please use us and never exchange us with other people till the day we meet you. Ameen, 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 ya Rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.